Welcome to Take That With You with Falwell and Damaris, sponsored by NTTA, a playoff preview edition. We'll get to everything Mavs Clippers. We'll also have a little bit of recap of the season. Mark Falwell is joining me as usual. Mavs on Mavs, I like it.
Well, hey man, it's playoff time. We're going to get this thing going on Sunday. We're recording on early Monday afternoon. As always, I took the Dallas North Tollway to get down here to the office. NTTA, as you pointed out, longtime sponsor of Take That With You. So please, Mavs fans, this is the time. If you want to show off your Mavs pride, you can get an official Mavs toll tag. It keeps the Mavs front and center on your windshield, and it helps you cut your toll bill in half with the colors that are too sweet. Get yours for just $19.99 at getmytolltag.com. Small sticker, big savings.
We've had a ton of people checking our pods lately. Interest in the Mavs is sky high. Just so everybody knows, we will not be doing the weekly schedule going forward. We're going to be coming at you after key games. So make sure you subscribe to your YouTube channel, and you will get a notification as soon as these drop. They won't even wait till the 5 o'clock usual drop window in the afternoon. We will put these out. If you get your audio on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, subscribe, get them as soon as they drop, because we're going to be coming at you. They'll be little digestible 30-minute pods after key games a lot more often than this once a week. So we are excited to bring you as much Mavs content as we possibly can.
Yeah. By the way, it is interesting that you said that interest in the Mavs is sky high. I got my Mavs City Edition from this year City Edition jersey t-shirt on with the Mavs hat. I almost wore my High Pointers shirt today that you got me, because just watch.
Oh, we have a big week.
Watch the socials, and we'll see. You know, we'll see when the next high pointing excursion is. You know, last year I'd already done Guadalupe Peak, High Point of Texas before, but last summer Guadalupe Peak, Texas, Black Mesa, Oklahoma, almost 5,000 feet over sea level, 4,900 and change, 4,938, I believe, and Mount Elbert in Colorado, the second highest point in the contiguous United States at 14,440 feet. So what high point will be next? Could be some news very soon.
Mark Falwell taking advantage of his week off.
Yeah, we'll see.
Okay.
We'll see what happens.
I do have to admit, now we have been teasing the eclipse for a long time. Last week we were, frankly, I was concerned for you because it was looking pretty dire.
Yeah.
And the clouds parted at Damaris HQ, where we used to do our old podcast. I got the full Monty.
Yeah.
I had the full unencumbered totality. And I have to say, it was pretty darn cool. It was amazing how the birds were chirping, and then everybody went quiet. The only sounds I heard were the school children at North Dallas High School near me screaming and cheering.
Yeah.
But I had a perfect view from my backyard, and I, as someone who liked to tease you as a skeptic.
Yeah. It was pretty cool, wasn't it?
The actual science of it is great, but it's just about the fact that everybody's looking at the same thing. We have this communal experience. To me, that's kind of how it makes you feel as a person in this community is what's important about it.
Yeah, that's interesting you say that, because I saw a lot of people echoing those very same sentiments on the socials on Monday. And
I was worried about you, but I'm glad that it worked out. It seems as though I got a little bit more totality than you did down further north.
Yes, we had great sky viewing for a lot of the lead up to totality. And then, of course, we did have a cloud move over during a portion of totality. We saw some. So I guess, you know, at that point, it's like, if I don't get to see the whole 3 minutes and 40 seconds, at least I saw a minute of it, or a minute 15 or a minute 20, whatever it was. I don't even know. I wasn't timing it. I was so like, are we going to see it? Is it about to go away? Oh, it just went away. Is it going to appear again? What's happening? I cannot believe this. So
yeah, go on Mark's Twitter feed and you can see his play-by-play.
Yeah. It's on my IG. It's on the Instagram as well. So,
well, I'm glad that it worked out. It was a very cool experience.
So this is like a total audible before we get into our Mavs talk here. But one real quick Mavs note, and also this is now on my Twitter and on my IG. Do you know, I don't even know if you've seen this, do you know what the most viewed clip of a play in the NBA this year was on the NBA social and digital media platforms? I totally forgot to tell everybody this when I walked in today. So, trivia question before we get started into the playoff preview and the recap of the final week of the regular season. I
mean, it's got to be Kyrie's shot, right?
It is not. Would you like to take another guess? Anybody off mic? Bobby Cat Chopper in here?
I did not see this. So is it Luka's scoop shot against Houston?
It is not. Bobby, do you want to shout out a guess off mic? Oh, he does. Chopper, do you know what it is? Okay, Chopper, do you have a guess? Okay, Chopper doesn't have a guess. All right. The answer is, with 250 million views on March 21st against the Utah Jazz, Luka diving on the floor for the loose ball, down on his butt, pass to Kyrie coming up the floor, alley-oop to Derrick Jones Jr.
Love that play.
Yes. So that was it against the Utah Jazz, March 21st, 250
You know what I like about that play?
Million views on social and digital media platforms. And there it is. Hey, great job, Chop. Great job.
Yeah, so, yes, those of us listening, you can always check us out on the YouTube channel, youtube.com/Mavericks. We'll have video podcasts, of course, throughout the playoffs. You know what I like about that play? I'm glad you mentioned that.
The league's leading scorer got down on the floor.
It was a hustle play by your best player, and that lifts everybody up and says, I got to go do that dirty work. If he's doing the dirty work, I'm doing the dirty work. That's leadership. We're going to talk about Pravi MVP in a bit.
Yeah.
But the big part of this is the leadership he has shown on and off the court, as well as what he's done playing-wise, as well as what he does amazingly offensively.
And a very unselfish play, I would add, by Kyrie as well.
Of course. The big news, of course, is, I don't know if you saw this, but I'm sure you did, the KP pick is finally going to be sent to the Knicks.
Yeah.
5 years later.
And the funny thing about it is the Mavs and Knicks will actually be in a drawing later this week for whoever gets 24 and whoever gets 25. But the pick will be conveyed, whatever it is, 24-25.
And as you look at that, that's pretty good for the Mavericks. You're giving up the 24th or 25th pick.
Yeah, and what people feel like is a very subpar draft.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to characterize it.
All first-round picks are not created equal.
Yeah, I don't want to characterize it as dire as some people are saying, because I think there's always going to be players in every draft. You just got to go find them. But, there's a lot of really dire predictions about this draft, and it will be a pick way, way in the first round. So it all works out nicely.
So we're going to get into Mavs-Clippers preview. We're going to talk about the playoffs in general, but you wanted to touch on a few things from a key week where the Mavericks had to solidify their positioning and continue the momentum they were getting going into the playoffs.
I think the Charlotte and Miami games from Tuesday and Wednesday deserve at least a little bit of a revisit here, because the way the Mavs started the game against Charlotte, I thought, was very important. Luka came out and really keyed a huge first quarter. You're going to see some highlights of him scoring 21 points in the first quarter of that game and route to a 39-point triple-double that night. But given the emotional high, I mean sky high, to use a term that's already been used in this podcast, the sky high emotions of the Houston Rockets overtime win on Sunday afternoon, then to go play Tuesday night in Charlotte, I did have concerns.
Right after the Golden State sky high emotional
win. I had concerns, Brian, about you're playing Charlotte. They've won 19 games. The arena is not going to have any energy or buzz, so to speak, in the Hornets Arena at the Spectrum Center in Charlotte. And the Mavs came out and did what they needed to do to generate their own energy. Great start. And, you know, it was Charlotte made a little run, but it was fine. Next night in Miami, Mavericks go there.
Back to back.
Miami's playing out a back to back as well. They played Atlanta the night before and had to go to double overtime, so maybe they were a little heavy legged at the beginning of the game.
But still can play really intense physical basketball.
Yes. And the Mavericks came out and really seized control of this game in the first quarter and continued to push forward in the second quarter, really took control of it there, opened up a big lead, and then you're seeing highlights of defense in this game. For the duration of the game, the Mavericks held Miami to 92 points. Forced a lot of turnovers in that game. You saw the block shot there at the end if you're watching on YouTube with Daniel Gafford. I do think that's important because not only is it defense, but Miami is a good team. And what I liked about that game is the Mavericks jumped out to a big lead. It's certainly conceivable they're going to jump out to a nice lead in one of these playoff games against the Clippers in the first round. But what is the NBA? It's a game of runs. And I really gravitated towards talking about this on the broadcast that night with Devin. I loved the response. I love that they got put in that position. Well, I mean, it would have been nice, actually, to win it going away. But they got put in that position.
You want to learn lessons.
Yes, you want to learn lessons, and they responded. And so I thought those two games, the approach, which means that then Dallas culminated, Brian, 5 games in 7 days with
very tough stretch.
A hard-fought win at home over Atlanta. It didn't go down to the wire, but it was a tough game for both teams.
After an 11-game road trip that went California, Texas.
Yeah, 5-game, 11-day road trip, 6,200 travel miles, I believe. So they play on Thursday. Tough game. Friday, no Luka, beat Golden State with a P.J. Washington shot at the end. 22-point comeback to win a thriller against Houston. Go play a bad team and go have the right approach for that game. And then go play a good Miami team where both teams were clearly having to like really summon some reserves in that game. And the Mavs summoned more reserves to build up a big lead and then respond to a run at the end and silence a home crowd. And so the 5 wins in 7 days was great. I thought the 2 wins at the end of it, I love the approach because what that did is, as your lower third graphic says, the approach in those 2 games then rendered the final 2 games essentially formalities. You know, yes. there was that little teeny tiny chance of moving up to 5th, but obviously the Mavs didn't see that there was a realistic chance of that. The Clippers would have done what they needed to do.
Yes.
If
they wouldn't
really
have lost the Utah game, they would have played their starters throughout.
Yeah, because they pulled the plug on their starters pretty early in that game once they knew that the Mavs were losing the game or had lost the game to the Detroit Pistons. So, and by the way, I'm glad that Dallas approached it that way. 2 years ago, we learned a very painful lesson. The Mavs played on the last night of the season with a chance to move up, but not controlling their own destiny. Luka played into the third quarter, into the second half of the final game of the season, and what happened? He got hurt. Now, thank goodness it worked out okay. Brunson was great. The Mavericks won 2 of the first 3 games without him, and they went on to win the series and had that great run. But I'm very glad that they learned their lesson from yes. what happened 2 years ago, and there's no need to risk it in a game that doesn't mean anything when you don't control your own destiny, and you can look and use common sense and realize they're not going to lose.
Yeah, 3 goals in those last 2 games. Number 1 was health, number 2 was health, and number 3 was getting good minutes for players who needed to either come back from injury or rotation players that may be called upon in the playoffs.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
Josh Green, who needed yeah. to get back into rhythm, and like a player like Jaden Hardy, who, listen, remember the 2011 run? You needed Corey Brewer, 1 game.
Yeah.
To make
yeah.
a difference, to win that game 1 in L.A., you never know whether because of foul trouble or injury, you're going to have to call on somebody who may not be in your playoff rotation to be a key contributor. And if you get some confidence and some play, even in those late games, that's important. So that was what's important. So they got their health. They got their rest. Now, if we open the lens back, go to the All-Star game and mm-hmm. what they've yeah. accomplished. You know, I wrote an article, right, coming out of the All-Star break.
Yes, you did.
The day of the Phoenix game, which was the first game
mm-hmm.
they won. And I said, here's what they need to do. Here's your goal for the stretch run.
Yeah, 18-9 stretch run, and that's with punting the last 2 games.
You want to get your rotations set. You want to know what your starting lineup is. You want to know what your closing lineup is. You want to know what your schemes are and how you're playing a new type of defense with these new players added to your roster. What you do offensively because you can play like that for 48 minutes. Role definition for each of those players. Momentum, health, chemistry, all of that. And frankly, they accomplished all of it.
Yeah, they did.
Not easy to juggle all those at the same time and be able to get there, but they can play versatile. Nico Harrison said it with Brad Townsend this week. We have the players now, or we don't have to play the way we have to play. We can play the way we want to play.
Mm-hmm.
You can play big, like they did against Denver. You can play small, like we've seen them play with either PJ or Maxey at the 5. And we'll talk about how that's going to be important. And they're playing on both ends. Since the All-Star break, before these last 2 games, which I'll throw out, they were 5th in defense.
Mm-hmm.
Since March 6th, which was after that Indiana game, during this 16-2 run, 16-1 with Luka on the floor, before these last 2 games,
yeah.
number 1 in defense.
Yeah, that's right.
That is the key. Luka and Kyrie playing so well has been the most important factor, but the defense has been absolutely huge. And when you're playing with pace and you're playing the half-court offense they are, that's the recipe for why they've been so effective.
And look, the move was the Gafford-Jones move into the starting lineup. You know, they, as you said, they were going to experiment. They had to settle on things. Experimentation, to what degree that's responsible for losing games, who knows? But they did lose some games. They did have to, you know, as was stated after that Indiana game, everything is on the table as it relates to lineups, rotations, etc. And the thing that was on the table was to change 2/5 of the starting lineup. It was what we suggested they should do, as a matter of fact, on the podcast that we recorded that day after the Indiana game. The other thing they did when they could, because obviously D-Live wasn't healthy the whole time, but the other thing that we suggested was that they needed to play bigger for a longer stretches of the game, and they had a run there for a long period of time before Lively got hurt, where every game Gafford and Lively were playing 40-plus minutes combined. So, yeah, they and then thank goodness that, you know, the Maxi PJ small ball lineup with Maxi at the five and PJ playing the four, that lineup really shined and was effective in a lot of games late in the season. So even without Lively, they were able to show, okay, this is our small ball unit, and it was quite effective. Good defense by Kleba in the Atlanta game and the Houston game and the Miami game. All of those situations come to mind where he was effective as his shot, by the way, was a little better.
Yes, he's ramping up. And if you remember 2 years ago,
not a ton of shots, but the percentages are good. Low volume, but good percentage.
2 years ago, he had a really rough stretch going in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And then as soon as the playoffs started, he was on fire. Remember that game two?
He had eight threes. He had eight threes in game two after shooting 18% from three post All-Star break in that regular season.
So I got to thinking this because on Bally yesterday, we played the plays of the year. And it was a nice little 2 or 3 minute clip.
Yep.
And it was really kind of amazing. Mm-hmm. I actually commented about you because so many times you were on the clip going, "What? What's happening?" Or "This is amazing!" Or "Oh my gosh!" I mean, there were just so many plays
year.
Like that.
Yeah.
And so it got me thinking. We talked about it on post game with Dana and Steiny of what the play of the year was. And so I'm going to ask you, and I'm going to have my own play of the year and image of the year.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking our play of the year is probably the same, but I don't even know what you have for here. But my play of the year, as many as there are, and you could talk about Luka's passes, you could talk about, you know, his and one to get over 70 points, you could talk about the very first scoop shot off the glass
against Brooklyn. The 3-point hook shot against Brooklyn.
Talk about the PJ Washington play, the threes by Kyrie or Exum against Houston. But to me, it has to be Kyrie's left-handed 20-foot floater against Denver.
Yes, because and think about beyond the fact that it was an incredible shot, and it is play of the year worthy. It was a shot to win a game against the defending champs in a game where you had lost a pretty significant lead in the fourth quarter, and you actually had fallen behind. So it took Luka tying it, and then Kyrie winning it. And all of the it started a new winning streak. I believe that was the first game of a 7-game winning streak for Dallas after they had lost to Oklahoma City a couple of nights before. Luka had just come back. It was the culmination of a game where the Mavericks out-physicaled and out-toughed Denver. So they played big. And
Jokic Denver said they were bigger.
Yes. So it was a game that showed the Mavs could play with an elite team. And obviously you could, you know, certainly make the argument that Denver is as elite as it gets. They're the defending champs. I know Boston had the best regular season, but it's Denver's title until somebody pries the trophy out of their fingers, hands, whatever you want to call it. So I think that has to be the play of the year given. And it's an amazing shot by an amazing player.
And you know you see Luka's reaction of shock. You see Maxi Kleba's reaction of shock.
Yeah,
that shot right there of Luka just kind of putting his hands, kind of laughing like, "Oh, did I just see what I just saw?"
Yeah.
And again, we talked about it. Luka smartly diving to the basket, taking that defender Porter out of the play, I think it was Caldwell Pope out of the play.
You're right. Yeah, Caldwell Pope.
So that he couldn't be there to defend that left-hander. If this season becomes something really special in the next couple of months,
mm-hmm.
these are the types of moments you look back and go, that was exactly what you said when this team started believing that they were onto something.
Yeah, and I think the other thing, too, is that it just it follows in line with a lot of other things that happened this year. The Mavericks were infinitely better in clutch and late-game situations than they were last year. They made shots in those opportunities. They made shots to win games. They made shots to tie games. Dante Exum against Houston, for example, and was talking to a fairly high-ranking Mavericks individual about just great late-game out-of-bounds execution. And, you know, it's that game. It's the end of the Golden State game. Offense, PJ, defense stopping the last three-point attempt. End of the Houston game. They ran a great play for Kyrie. It didn't work. When they could have tied it with 20 seconds in regulation, but it was a great play.
Remember, they were 5-13 in the clutch after the trade deadline.
Yeah, the individual I talked to said, you know, we wanted to force them to make a pass after Houston inbounded. We wanted to have to foul Jabari Smith. That was one of our choices. Smith, Brooks, and if he had been in the game, Reggie Bullock. were the players that they wanted to foul. They didn't want to foul Van Vliet, and they didn't want to foul Jalen Green.
Younger player in Jabari Smith, even though a good free throw shooter.
Yes, correct. 83%, but good free throw shooter. They executed that well, and they got him on the line, and he missed. And so it just fit with a lot of really good late-game execution situations.
By the way, in that play, remember, they could have just fouled up three. But the reason they didn't foul Luka, because even though he's at the logo, he acted like he was going to shoot. Well, you don't foul at that point,
right.
And that made it too late. It was a brilliant move by Luka to suck that defense in, but not foul, because that was a little overlooked piece of that whole thing. But, yes, I think that was the the moment that was – you mentioned it. They had started winning. Obviously, Luka didn't play in that Oklahoma City game. They played well in that game, lost that game. This started the streak back up in a nationally televised game against the best team in the Western Conference. And so that gives you kind of this we believe type of feeling. Image of the year, and I think we saw it last week.
For sure, yeah.
Was the hug heard around the world.
Yeah.
The hug seen around the world.
Okay, Bobby Thompson.
Just, after that exhausting game in Houston where they were down big and they came back and the resilience and fought back. It's not only keeping leads, it's coming back big deficits, which we didn't see a lot of last year.
Yeah, 22.
And that
22
shot right there of just elation, exhaustion, chemistry, love, all the naysayers last year who said this wasn't going to work. And basically that put that to rest. And the best part of this whole thing is right there where it's your teammates too. Because remember, if Exum doesn't hit that shot, if they don't trust their teammates, if P.J. Washington, if Tim Hardaway doesn't make the right play at the end there, they don't get that win. And that image right there of those two studs who are putting their team on their back and then everybody else saying, we're all one, that's the image of the year to me so far.
It is. And by the way, as part of that, and we did not even like there was so much to talk about last night, this part of it didn't cross my mind. That was an afternoon game. It was still 2 days before the end of Ramadan. So Kyrie had 48 points and put the team on his back playing in an afternoon game where he was fasting.
You're talking about reigning player of the week, Kyrie Irving.
Reigning Western Conference player of the week,
which
Kyrie
he hadn't
Irving,
won in 9 years.
Which absolutely shocked me. Thanks to the great Brad Townsend for the Dallas Morning News. Kyrie's stats during Ramadan were 26.3 points per game, 36 minutes, 5.7 assists, 5 rebounds, 1.5 steals per game, 51% from the floor, 92% from the free throw line. Player of the Week award, take over the game quarters, and as he put it, one unforgettable game winner against Denver. So,
and percentage
Brad.
Points.
Yeah, really appreciate Brad bringing that to the table.
Percentage points from being 50-40-90.
Yes, for the whole season.
58 games.
Yep, for the whole season.
So, talking superlatives, let's give a little love to a few Mavs that should be getting some postseason awards. I want to start with Derek Lively.
Okay.
Remember, he was the 12th pick in the draft.
Mm-hmm.
And if we're ranking rookies, I mean, you've got Chet, you've got Wemby, you've got Brandon Miller, you've got Jaime Jaquez. Is he first team? Is first? I'll ask you. I don't even know the answer to this. Is all team rookie positionless as all NBA is?
Correct. It is. It is positionless.
So
I wrote it down. Okay. I wrote down what I thought. I think Wemby, Chet Holmgren, Brandon Miller, because he had good numbers on a team that is probably going to be in the playoffs. I assume Miami will be 7 or 8. I don't think they're going to get beat twice, with one of the games being Chicago or Atlanta. We'll see. But Jaime Jaquez was basically 12 points a game on a winning team. So I have him on the first team. And then for me, my debate came down to Derek Lively or Amen Thompson. Amen Thompson had some nice numbers in the game.
And obviously came on once Sengun got hurt, played more effectively at that five.
Yep. But he had some very, very nice numbers. Over 9 points a game, over 6 rebounds, around 3 assists a game, steals. Obviously neither one of the Thompson twins are good 3-point shooters. They're both in the teens percentage wise this year, but he still shot over 50% from the floor for a big chunk of the year because of his ability, and maybe did for the whole year. I'd have to go back and look at his numbers. So I went with Lively first team and Amen Thompson the headliner of the second team, along with Brandon Podziemski, Scoot Henderson. Just my opinion on this one. I thought at 19 years old, I thought G.G. Jackson had
no issue with that.
Yeah, given he's the youngest player in the league, and I know it was a bad Memphis team, but he got a lot of minutes and played well. And I feel like that this is the coach in me coming out, Trace Jackson Davis,
Played very well.
Yeah, would be my other pick. If I were going to round out.
I don't have any issues with any of that. We are in agreement. I did not know that ahead of time. And so, yes, I agree. I think he should be first team all rookie for what he did. Remember, starting game one, when we did this in the summer after the draft, we were like, he may play in the G League some, give him a few years. He started game one.
Started game two. But
excuse me.
31 minutes,
I think. But outplayed Wemby in game one.
Yes, 31 minutes, I believe, in game one.
And closed the game in game one.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that first preseason game, you and I did that from Abu Dhabi.
Yeah.
And not from Abu Dhabi. The game was in Abu Dhabi. And he, you know, looked like a rookie playing his first meaningful NBA time.
Yeah.
And really developed throughout the summer, throughout preseason, to where they had the, you know, a guy who didn't have a double-double in college. And what did he end up, 9-7?
Yeah, almost 7 rebounds. Yeah, maybe. And a block and a half. And had D Live played 58 games, he got hurt and ended up playing, I believe, 52. But had he played 58 games, then he would have been in the top 20 in the league in block shots. He was 13th or 14th.
And the field goal percentage, if he had played enough?
Well, you know, that's based on field goal makes.
But if he had.
Yeah, but he would have led the league.
Yeah, so there you go. I mean,
he shot 74 we know what point he's, something
you
percent.
Know, the vertical game that he had, the rim protection, the high basketball IQ, the high character. Basically, before Gafford here, he was anchoring that center lineup as a rookie and doing that at 19, and it's only going to grow from here.
I had a positive net rating as a rookie player on a good team, and I think that's, you know, that's something to focus on.
Before we get to Luka, we got to talk about Nico
and
his team, which is led by Matt Riccardi, Andrew Baker, and Terry Sullivan, and Dennis Lindsay, amongst many, many others.
Michael Finley,
Yes, Michael Finley as well. Big basketball operations staff over there. And it really struck me, as I mentioned last week, when they won the Golden State game without Luka, where all the starters were players that have been acquired in the last 14 years.
Yeah.
So if we're giving Executive of the Year love, and listen, it'll probably go to Brad Stevens for the acquisition of Jrue Holiday and Kristaps Porzingis.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at what Nico's done.
I have something to throw out there, too, along who may get it. Yeah, when you get a chance.
When you talk about the acquisition of Kyrie Irving 14 months ago.
Right.
And really the national punditry being against it in a large way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, overwhelmingly.
Getting here this summer, your big swing was Grant Williams, but you did something with it.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't just, you know, sit on your sunk cost. You, you were able to turn it into something productive. But the smaller moves you made, Dennis Lindsay obviously being a key factor in signing Dante Exum, getting him out of Serbia, you know, having the international scouting to go do that, get him in a 2-year deal so you got him locked up for next year at a nice price.
Right.
Go getting, you know, you didn't get Matisse Thybulle, so you went and got Derrick Jones Jr., who'd played on 7 teams in 8 years and turned him into somebody who can be effective offensively as well as what he does lobbying and, of course, the you know, your best perimeter defender. And then going at midseason and turning Grant Williams into P.J. Washington and then getting Daniel Gafford, which transformed everything for on so many levels. You know, you're talking about outside of your stud in Luka, your other 4 starters and 2 key players off the bench, all acquired in the last year to 14 months, that's pretty solid.
I tell you, if you and the executive of the year is voted on by other executives in front offices. You brought up Brad Stevens. I would also think, before I tell you who, if you were just going to say, we're going to vote on executive of the year
and
based
I have
on what
too.
You did, what you did from the end of last year.
Which is what it should be, right?
In my opinion, yes. What you did.
So
from
the Kyrie trade doesn't count, but the Kyrie signing does.
Yeah. What you did from the disappointing end of the season at 38-44 and not even making the play-in tournament, realizing you had heavy lifting to do, a big-time rebuild to say, we think Kyrie and Luka can work. We're gonna now we've got to put the right players around them. And, of course, you had to re-sign Kyrie, and you had to come to the table with an offer. And as his mother-in-law's agent said, you know, Chatelle O'Reilly Irving, that, you know, they made us an offer that made it clear they wanted us and they wanted this to be Kyrie's home. And he plays and carries himself like someone who feels like this organization, this city, this community, this fan base is home.
The culture Nico built has made it welcoming for Luka and Kyrie.
Then the roster moves that you've already delineated, Brian. So if you're talking about the guy who took what he had at the end of last year and turned it into what it is at the end of this year, that's executive of the year worthy. I don't know how the executives think about this. It almost seems to me like they kind of vote on, well, more a long range, like how you put a team together. I wonder if they're going to vote for Sam Presti. And just
that,
say,
that was the other name.
All of the moves that you've made put your team in position to jump to being the number one seed.
But to your
in the
point,
West.
That's a longer term thing.
Correct.
And I don't have an argument either way because, yeah, he may not have made specific moves in the last year, but the longer.
Yeah,
pull the lens out.
Yes,
it's pretty amazing what he's been able to accomplish.
I mean, they've been doing this for 5 years. If you go all the way back to having to
trade
Paul George,
those are the three
to the
names
Lakers
that I think
Shea.
Are in there.
But Brad Stevens is a good point because it's taking the roster you had at the end of last year and then making moves to fortify it this year with what they've done. And they have done obviously a nice job with the additions of KP and Drew.
Before we get to Luka, two quick things. One. And I saw this on quite a few NBA writers over the last week have started giving Exum some most improved player
okay.
love.
I thought you were about to tell me something that was going to like make me mad.
Okay,
but you did not. Okay. If
Exum
girding my loins for that.
If Exum had played like this and not been hurt for that long stretch, I think you would have to – I think Maxey should win this award, but I think you would have to give him – a lot of love there.
For most improved player you're talking about.
Kind of the spirit of the award is it's almost comeback player of the year-ish, but he's been pretty amazing at what he's been able to do.
Mm-hmm.
And then not really award level, but you know, Gafford did have the 20-plus consecutive field goal streak, the only person to have two of those in the last 27 years.
Yeah.
And maybe even longer, but that's how we've been keeping the records of it.
Right.
He's going to win field goal percentage.
Yep, 72.5%. Daniel Gafford, the third highest field goal percentage for a qualifying player in NBA history. Mitchell Robinson a few years ago, Wilt back in 72-73 with the Lakers. And he almost caught Wilt, by the way. Wilt was 72-7. Daniel Gafford was 72-5.
And in his Mavs time, if that had been throughout the year, it would have been number one throughout the NBA. And
yeah,
NBA history.
It's like 78%,
yes.
Right? 77-something.
But... we have to get to Pravi MVP Luka. We're gonna wind Falwell up.
Yeah.
If you listened to the postgame show on the ticket the other night, he was in rare form.
Yeah. It was really frustrating to see Wednesday to see people, oh, hey, the MVP race is over. Thanks for playing. And then I didn't hear anybody say whenever Denver lost on Friday night, Brian, to Wimby and a bunch of guys named Sandro Mamukelashvili. When San Antonio was down 23 points and Denver had a chance to effectively wrap up the number one seed, they just had a very, very poor performance against San Antonio and blew it and lost the game at the end. They had a five-second call at the end of the game, and Devontae Graham made a winning basket with 0.9 seconds. And it just really is – it's strange to me that if we're going to say a great game against Minnesota solidifies the MVP and then 48 hours later you do that, which there are a lot of adjectives and verbs I would like to use to characterize that performance that I can't, so I won't. On our old podcast, I could say some of those things, but in this case, we don't want to offend anybody on YouTube or anything like that, so we won't do that. But I was, as you know, as I was wound up the other night talking about this with Luka and the MVP, and just, you know, there's another weird argument that's going on now that says, well, he got off to a slow start. It's like, what? He did not get off to a slow start this year. What are we doing? What are we talking about? Why are we talking about kitchen sink win probability as part of the MVP race?
That's a real term.
We're playing basketball. We're not playing plumbing. We bounce the ball. We pass the ball. We shoot the ball. We don't worry about the grease traps in this game. What are we doing? I don't understand, because we're about to show a whole lot of like really awesome numbers this year that are about bounce the ball, pass the ball, shoot the ball, score the ball, about basketball and not about plumbing. I don't understand.
And that is where the issue comes to me. If Jokic or Shea win, great. Congratulations. Absolutely well-deserving. But to say that this is closed, and I've heard numerous national people smart basketball minds say case closed on this, that it's for Jokic. That I don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be interesting to see.
Giving myself a headache.
How this plays out. With Shea getting, with Oklahoma City getting one, does that move him maybe even, you know, getting a lot more first place votes because Denver didn't win the West? You know, the thinking is best player on best team kind of stuff. We have talked about that over and over. Let's go through the numbers. Let's go through.
Yeah, one more time.
These are now updated final regular season numbers. And oh, by the way, ballots went out today.
Right.
Because of the 65-game rule, it used to be, back when you were voting, you would get them a week in advance and turn them
or
in
more. Yeah.
By today at noon. They aren't due till Thursday.
Yep.
So, you know, whatever's happened in this last week is all baked in, and maybe there's some, you know, thinking about it. But go through the list.
Most points created per game. This is the points you score plus the points you generate and assist. Most in NBA history, 57.2. Most combined points, rebounds, and assists since 71-72. They outdistanced Westbrook, or Luka outdistanced Westbrook's 52-7 and his MVP when he averaged a triple-double. So Luka had 52-9. You got to go back to Kareem in 71-72. One of four players to finish the season in the top 15 of points, rebounds, assists, and steals per game.
That's huge right there.
Yeah, and he was on the knife edge in that regard. And the Clippers punting the game against Utah on Friday night jumped Utah back into the top, jumped Luka back into the top 15 because Zubats ended up playing, I think, only 10 minutes on Friday night. So his rebounds per game went down just enough for Luka to leapfrog him to go back into the top top 15. I think when we had this graphic
it was
or
top
something
20.
Similar.
One of seven of top 20.
Yeah, so he ends up being one of four players to finish the season top 15 points, rebounds, assists, steals, first points, 15th in rebounds, second in assists, and eighth in steals. Second most 30-point triple-double since 1970-71 was 16. Westbrook had the most.
And he now owns the longest streak of 30-point triple-doubles and 35-point triple-doubles.
Yeah, with six straight 30-point triple-doubles that occurred in late February, early March. First player ever to average 33 points, 9 boards, 9 assists.
No one's even averaged 33, 8, and 8. And
Jordan
he basically...
Did, yeah, as we brought up last year, Jordan and Luka both had 32, 8, and 8 last year.
And Luka's at 33, 9, is that correct? So this is essentially 34?
Yeah, 33.86. The 18th highest scoring average in league history is what it ends up being. So almost 33.9 a game. And that 33.9, there you see it on the last note. Fourth highest scoring average in the last 35 years. Harden, Kobe... And I forgot now. I think it was maybe Allen Iverson had a year where it was higher than that. So those are those three guys, and then you'd have to go, and, you know, you start seeing like some of the really high Michael Jordan years in the late 80s, like 86, 87, 87, 88, surpassing that. And now you're seeing highlights, by the way, from 73 points. By the way, he also had a game that tied for the fourth highest scoring output in a game in NBA history.
And the only player who scored 72 or more points to have more than two assists. The numbers speak for themselves, Mark. It's a matter of if, not when. His leadership starting last summer after the devastating season, he committed to conditioning,
yep,
to his body, to his mental well-being. He put a team around him that, you know, his body team, as Nico called it last week, and he is committed to that. That has shown late in games, late in season, leading this team on and off the court. The diving for the balls, what you mentioned, mm-hmm, showing that on the, you know, being in the steals, top 10 and top 20 in steals, top 10 in steals, on the defensive end, coexisting with Kyrie in a way that they're hugging at the end of the year because of the 1+1=3, having your trust in your teammates, making it an atmosphere that's loose but hardworking,
mm-hmm,
all of that together,
which is really important. Yep,
is an MVP. Worthy season. If he doesn't win it, listen, we know what we saw.
Yeah.
And
I think you brought it up several times before that history will not look favorably on not giving Luka the MVP this year if in fact he doesn't, you know, be voted in. And I don't think that's going to happen. It will really look bad if it looks like the last straw poll that came out a couple of weeks ago where he only had one first place vote. It seems like that there's a little bit more momentum. And by the way, the other thing that's happened here is 50 wins, moving up to the 5 seed. So all of these things that we had said earlier in the year that in the past, a precedent has been set for 6 seeds and high 40s in wins. That has happened twice in very recent history. And I get it that every year is different, of course, but when you've established this precedent, and there is some revisionist history, by the way, going on in some of those things because people say, well, there weren't other worthy candidates. Well, of course there were other worthy candidates. I've gone back and looked at those years. There were absolutely worthy candidates who had similar or close to numbers on better teams, on teams with better records. And it was just felt like that Westbrook averaging a triple-double Harden had fantastic numbers. I mean, I think Harden was 29 points, 8 boards, and 11 assists that year on a Houston team that won 6 or 7 more games and was maybe a second or third seed in the Western Conference. So there has been a precedent, not only for voting a 6 seed with a high 40s win total, but also for that person being named MVP with some pretty strong competition on better teams being them winning over those individuals. So,
well, let's see what happens.
It's really upsetting me, as you can tell.
Yes, and you know that I've been on this train. We've been on this train for a long time now, and it was great to see the Mavs with their Pravi MVP shirts in Miami supporting it, the organization supporting it. And it is time to look ahead to the Clippers.
The third time in the last 5 years.
The trilogy.
Yep. Played in 2020 in the bubble, lost 4-2. Played in 2021 at the end of the 72-game season in a 4-5 matchup, Brian. Won 4-3 by the Clippers. Recall that the road team won the first 6 games of that series. Dallas 1-5 in L.A., the Clippers 3-4-6 here in Dallas at American Airlines Center, and then the Clippers pulled away in the second half and won big in Game 7. In the regular season, these two teams played 3 times. Clippers won the season series 2-1, but all of those games were very early in the season. Dallas won at home in November, the Clippers won on their home floor in late November, and then the Clippers won here on December the 20th. In the midst of a 9-game winning streak, as a matter of fact, I believe that was the 9th game and their 9-game winning streak, which ended the next night against the Thunder. And that was when they were playing some of their best basketball of the year. Kyrie Irving did not play in that game for the Mavericks. So a little background on the series.
You can throw all that out.
Yeah.
Frankly.
Exactly. Because the Clippers have not played this Maverick team.
The Clippers have been such an interesting team. They have said themselves they've had some funk, some focus issues. They were 33-10 at one point when they were really rolling, and then went, I believe, 15-15 after the break. Mm-hmm. Which Clippers team is going to show up? And really the question then becomes, how healthy is that team? Because I think that is a huge factor in which Clippers team is going to show up. And item number one on that agenda is Kawhi Leonard. He has not played the last 10 games of the season. When Ty Lue was asked this week, he said, quote, hopeful for game one. Mm-hmm. It is the right knee inflammation, the same knee that has caused him problems for so long. He played more games this year than he played since he was a San Antonio Spur.
Right.
And playing back-to-backs, playing a lot. You could see him return for game one as what happened last year and then not play. He played the first 2 games of that series, didn't play last year, and the Clippers were ousted, I believe, in 5 games.
And so, by the Phoenix Suns, right?
Right. Yeah. So, listen, playoff Kawhi is playoff Kawhi.
Mm-hmm.
He is a lockdown defender, and he can, just go pull up game 6 of 2-3 years ago.
Right.
And we know what he can be offensively, and he has led this team to that 33-10 run when he was playing really well.
You know, along those lines, Brian, you brought up 33-10. I looked at a stretch of games, and I thought, let's look at what the top end of each team is capable of. And I looked at from the 1st of December, they were 8-10, and they then proceeded to win 26 of their next 31 games, all the way through basically the 4th or 5th of February, something like that. And in that time frame, we're talking about a 124 offensive rating, which, is as good as there is in the NBA, but an average defensive rating in that time frame, 116. But the net rating was still just over 8 in that time frame. The Mavericks' best stretch of games, February 5th, when Kyrie Irving came back into the lineup after missing 6 games due to a sprained thumb. And then he played 31 straight games. 28 of those were after the trades. The Mavericks went 24-7 in that 31-game window. I didn't plan for him to work out as both 31-game comparisons. It just happened to do that. The Mavericks went 24-7 with an offensive rating of 118.5 and a defensive rating around 109 point something, between 109 and 110. It was a net rating that worked out to being a plus 8.7. So the Clippers' top end has been elite with a net rating of just over 8. The Mavericks' top end this year of essentially 40% of their season, almost 40% of their season, just like the Clippers, their top end was a net rating of nearly 9. over a stretch of that long to kind of give you, I thought it would be just, I was curious what the top end of both of these teams could be and how they matched up and compared to each other.
I think it's going to be a very difficult series.
For sure.
I think the Clippers are the second best team that they could have played in the West outside of Denver.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're going to play, I think, at a higher level than they've been playing in the playoffs. They're the 24th ranked defense since the trade. And mm-hmm. so they've got to get that identity back. But health-wise, listen, Harden's been dealing with some issues. Russell Westbrook is back. Zubats has been dealing with issues, but he's back.
Mm-hmm.
We'll just have to see, you know, with these essentially 10 days off for both teams of their regular players,
mm-hmm.
how that can help. And on the Mavs side, listen, Josh Green is back. Looks like he'll be able to play regular minutes come playoff time in the
Correct.
Rotation. Do we have an update on Derek Lively?
I mean, I wish that Jason Kidd had said hopeful yesterday. He said, we'll see. And we've got something to talk about at the end of the podcast as it relates to Derek Lively because, the things that he is going through right
sure.
now go past the physical part of it.
But he is off crutches, which is
yeah.
the good news. And
yeah.
we saw him walking around Friday night.
Correct. Correct. So as it relates to the injury, more updates to come. But at this point, I mean, all Kidd has gone on the record and said is we'll see, which is what he said yesterday. When the Mavs played a couple of weeks ago, he said that he was a couple of weeks away. I believe that those comments were before the April 2nd road game against the Warriors because he got hurt in the game in Houston
right.
that was played right before that. So that's when he went out, and J. Kidd said it's going to be a couple of weeks. He's never really wavered from that timetable other than to say, you know, we hope that with 2 weeks and then a week off between the end of the regular season and the playoffs, he'll be ready. But, stay tuned.
Before we get into some X factors, I want to talk quickly about Luka versus the Clippers. In playoff games, he's mm-hmm. 34-10-9 against the Clippers.
Wow.
Overall, against the Clippers regular season playoffs, he scored more points against the Clippers than any other opponent in the league.
Wow.
And as a matter of fact, his averages against the Clippers are the best of any player against any player in their conference
mm-hmm.
in the history of the league.
Mm.
And Michael Jordan, I believe, is the only one
wow.
who had a better record. And I can't remember who he's against either conference.
Wow.
So his numbers are huge. And we'll talk about why they are here in a bit. But Kawhi has been really good against playoff Mavs. He's 33-9-5.
Yeah, he's been great.
So those are the
like
stars.
Like you said, go put in the tape of Game 6 in 2021.
Yeah. Now, there's X factors.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about some game planning and what Kyrie brings and all of that. But my biggest X factor for the Mavs is P.J. Washington. I think on both ends of the floor, what he's going to be able to do, because he will probably be guarding Paul George.
Or perhaps Kawhi, because the reason I picked him as one of my guys X factor-wise is that he gives Dallas a better defensive matchup, theoretically, than they ever had against Kawhi Leonard. Because of size, length, et cetera.
And that's interesting because you'll put Jones on Harden, right?
Or is Jones on Paul George? Is that the direction that you're going to go? And that means that one of Kyrie or Luka are guarding Harden.
Right. And they're going to play pick and roll anyway, then you can switch off of that.
Right.
But I think what he brings defensively, listen, he can guard 1 through 5. I think he may be versatile where he may be a 5 some, and we'll get into some of that.
For sure. Yeah,
but offensively, his ability to get to the hole, that little floater game he has, and then those threes, which have been coming around, he's adjusted his shot and how he shoots it, that's going to be huge. We saw the potential of that in that Golden State win,
mm-hmm.
of what he can do and how explosive he can be. We know what Kyrie and Luka are, but somebody else in the center position, we talked about the center position as the third scorer, somebody else is going to have to carry some scoring burden.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he is the candidate for that, and he's going to be a really important piece.
Yeah, defensively, and I would say, like, I mean, the two guys, and maybe this is just, like, being really obvious, but it's the two players acquired that changed the look of the team, because Gafford would be my other X factor. You know, the other thing is, this is PJ's first time in the playoffs. Gafford did play in a first-round series that was, you know, over very quickly for the Wizards when they played in the playoffs in 2021. I don't even remember who they played. I think it was Philadelphia. I think that's who it was in a 1-8 matchup. So he's had one swim through the playoffs for a very short first-round series, and that's it. So we know what they give Dallas. I talked about the top-end numbers for the Mavs. But this is going to be a different situation for them playing in this competitive level of game. something which PJ has never done and Gafford has only done just a handful of times.
That's a really good point. And I think that for both of those players, we talked about those Sacramento games at the end of March being, you know, the biggest games of Gafford and PJ's career.
Mm-hmm.
So how important that was to vault the Mavs into this position where they have a week off and play in the playoffs. They haven't played at this level before.
Yeah.
And that is an adjustment. Kyrie's been there, of course. He's got a ring. Luka's been there. You know, Hardaway's been there. But these are important minutes for these guys, and there is an adjustment to playoff basketball. I think the other X factor for the Mavs is Dante Exum.
Mm-hmm.
We may see him closing a lot of games like we saw him doing down the stretch.
Mm-hmm.
His ability to be another long-rangey defender,
right,
but also hit those threes at a 50% clip, hit those clutch threes at a 75% clip, run the offense when needed to, be that third ball handler, be that connector, be that closer, diving into the lane, distributing. He's going to be an important piece of this.
Yeah, depending on who the Mavs are playing. I mean, you could have three guards and you could have two forwards out there and not a real true center in some late-game situations. And that means you would have Exum as somebody who could defend Harden, and then you would have your two bigger players, whether it's PJ Maxey or PJ and Jones, you know, trying to guard. Because I think there could be some game situations, late game situations, where Paul George and Kawhi Leonard are the Clippers' bigs.
Yeah, and we're going to get into that because I think that if I'm talking at a Clippers X factor, I think Zubats might be it because he's got to play effective minutes. You know, their rebounding is dependent on him, and their defense goes down when they play small. And a lot of, you look at Ty Lue said after that November loss to the Mavericks, we weren't big enough.
Yeah.
And so that brings me into two questions.
Well, and if I were going to look at a Clipper X factor real quick, Brian, to me, it's more Norman Powell. That's you know, look, Westbrook is very, very good in their second units.
Huge for them.
The change for the Clippers to go from Westbrook starting to Westbrook playing off the bench.
That changed everything.
It balances their starting lineup, moving Terrence Mann. It just
gives them more spacing in that unit and supercharges that second unit.
Yes, absolutely. But to me, like, Norman Powell reminds me a lot of, you know, different player, but certainly as capable of doing the things that Reggie Jackson did in the past. And Reggie started a lot of those games.
That's a good point.
But I like Powell as the Clipper X factor. I've always liked him as a player. I think he got big time short end of the stick last year in the Sixth Man of the Year voting because he was the leading scorer amongst Sixth Man of the Year eligible players last year. So, you know, one of the things I would say about the Clippers, if we're going to compare from 2021 Clippers to 2024 Clippers in this matchup, their top-end offensive talent and offensive capabilities, I think, are better. Obviously, Harden's your third player now to go with George and Leonard. You've got Westbrook. You've got Norman Powell. And Norman Powell kind of aligns, in my opinion, again, with perhaps Reggie Jackson when you look back at those teams. But here's a difference that I see, and this will get into how they play, you know, and small and defensively and that sort of thing, is I don't see the playoff grit toughness element to the degree that they had 3 years ago. Marcus Morris, Beverly, Rondo, please don't laugh. Rondo played important minutes in games in that 2021 series, particularly in game six. So
Batum,
yes,
Jackson.
Batum. Thank you. Yes, Batum. That's a name I forgot.
And they were long defenders.
Yeah.
They caused problems. Remember, the Mavs had to go to zone with Boban in the middle.
Yeah.
To try to be effective to stop that dribble penetration, what they were doing offensively, because what they were doing was they were attacking inside, either Kawhi or PG gets his shot, or they were playing swing-swing with Batum on one end and Morris on the other, just jacking threes up.
Yeah, I see more elite offense, less in terms of glue guys, if we're comparing those the iterations of the Clippers then and the Clippers now as it relates to this playoff matchup, which is why I think Powell, because he can get after it. You know, he can hold his own on the defensive end of the floor, you know, and so he's got some toughness and some grit to his game. And, you know, not that you see it all the time, but I certainly think it's there, and we'll see how that, you know, plays out in the series.
And James Harden has solidified their offense. You know, they needed a point guard. Mm-hmm. They had to have somebody to kind of run things for them, and he has done that. And his pick and roll game with Zubats is effective when you've got Paul George and Kawhi as your outlets on there, and he's played well for them. So this brings me to two questions.
Okay.
One is, the Mavericks have feasted on the pick-and-roll game. Let's just assume Lively's available and can play, and they can play for 48 minutes if they want to offensively. Gafford obviously has done that. We know what Luka wants to do. He wants to put Zubats on him.
He's going
to call Zubats' guy up and play the pick-and-roll game. Well, you would think Zubac's guy is going to be Gafford, and then you can play the Gafford pick-and-roll, and it, you know, we've talked over and over what that means in terms of pick your poison.
Mm-hmm.
What if the Clippers put Zubac on Derrick Jones Jr. in the corner?
Then that's obviously an impediment to the Mavericks playing the pick-and-roll game as effectively as they would like to, as consistently and effectively as they would like to.
So that's going to be part of the chess match that we're going to see.
Mm-hmm.
Because, listen, Ty Lue knows that's going to be the first play. I mean, we just know that's going to happen.
Right.
Then you've got to put Jones in. Now, Jones obviously can dive and roll and sky and all that, but that's not the best version of the Mavs offense.
Right, right.
So that's going to be interesting to see how effective Gafford and those guys can be, because listen, Gafford's not a guy you dump the ball down to. If you put a smaller player on him, you know, it's not like you can take advantage of that in the post.
Not posting up, but that doesn't mean that you still, you know, that if a smaller player turns his head or if a smaller player is in a bad position, that you still couldn't throw it up high to him and be in a position for lobs or catches.
That's right. He can be in the dunker spot. Now, that then begs the question, do they put Paul George on him to try to avoid some of that? Because the interesting question that the Clippers need to answer is, do you double Luka or not?
Because I think that the second Sacramento game, there were situations where the Mavericks got several dunks in the game, but I saw some discussion online about this. They weren't getting them in the pick and roll as much, but they were getting situations where Luka dribble penetrates, draws in the defense, and then you thread the needle through a crowd to somebody standing in the dunker spot. I believe one really good example of that I saw was Lively in the second Sacramento game. So I do think that that is an element for the bigs in this series is, you know, if you're in the dunker spot and you break down the defensive dribble penetration and draw in other people and make drop-off passes, are you in position to capitalize on that?
That's something to look at, is the effectiveness of those centers when that vertical game may not be there like it's used to seeing it.
Right.
Now, the question the Clippers have to ask is, do I double or not?
Mm-hmm.
Because if you don't double, then Luka can cook.
Right.
But if you do double, do they just say, okay, especially when Kyrie's not in the game, I'm going to force the other players to beat me.
Right, which would be probably a pretty sound strategy.
Now, 4-on-3 is good. You want to play advantage basketball. Luka talks all the time about it. He wants to play that. But in the playoffs, especially with these new players that aren't used to this level, might you see that, especially when Kyrie's in there, then he can kind of run things and get in the lane and be that secondary initiator. But in those minutes when he's out and Luka's in, and we see that often, you might see trapping and doubling then, and then you might see them play single coverage because they do have good defenders. I mean, you can switch Paul George on him. Terrence Mann is a pest on him.
Yep.
Kawhi obviously can handle that. P.J. Tucker can handle that. He's not going to give you anything offensively, but he's a dogged defender.
I saw you mention that in one of your texts to me, and I did look today. So P.J. played 16 games after the All-Star break, averaging 15.5 minutes a game. In those games, I think he shot 19 threes and made 8 of them, and I think maybe just took 2 or 3 two-pointers. So he didn't, you know, he's not shooting a lot. I mean, we're talking about essentially 2 points and 3 rebounds in 16 minutes of the game that he played. P.J. Tucker did not play in a game, Brian, from the 27th of November, I believe, until after the All-Star break. So what are their plans for him? Who knows? But Tucker was like in mothballs for 2 months of this year. They went back to him after the All-Star break. He's got a lot of playoff experience, championship experience. To me, if the Clippers go small,
and this is the second big question now, when Zubac is not in the game, they're going to go small.
So you're not thinking we're going to see very much Daniel Tice or Mason Plumlee?
I mean,
maybe a little, but I'm kind of with you. I don't think we're going to see much of those guys.
Their rebounding and defense does take a hit when they go small. I just think that to get Gafford and – well, the question then becomes, are they going to go small, and what do the Mavericks do to respond? Because maybe they go small to get Gafford and Lively off the floor. So the question becomes, what do the Mavs do when they do go small? Because I think we're going to see a healthy diet of that.
I would say who are they going small with? Because if P.J. Tucker's the player, then I think that you can do the thing that you're talking about with Zubac and Derrick Jones.
You're saying
put Zubac on Jones because – let's think about the lineup that the Clippers could play small ball if they wanted to. This would be supercharged offense. Westbrook, Powell, Harden, George, Kawhi.
Yes, and I think you will see that. Or substitute man for Westbrook so that the spacing, you know,
okay,
you can't
so,
just lay off
So when you play man or when you play P.J. Tucker, then you could do what you're talking about, and that is, okay, we'll Sag stay off. Big. We'll stay big and leave Gafford or Lively on the floor. But who would they cover if they played the five-man lineup I just talked about of Kawhi and Paul George are your bigs, and you're going with guards of Westbrook, Powell, and Harden? I mean, that would be a wild offensive lineup, by the way. That would be a super potentially lethal offensive lineup that obviously would have some other things, some other factors that you would have to, you know, that the Clippers would be concerned about. But, I mean, to me, that plays Gafford and Lively off the floor.
That's right. That's the question. And then...
because who would they cover?
Right.
Yeah,
and
you can't hide them on a P.J. Tucker or Terrence Mann.
So that means you have to play Maxey at the five or P.J. at the five.
Yeah.
With, you know, Exum, Hardaway, and your two studs. Offensively, you become isolation basketball because then they're switching everything defensively.
Correct.
You don't have that vertical game that's getting you the mismatches. Mm-hmm. That's not an optimal version of your offense. Then you're staying home on shooters. You don't have the open looks from three. You know, that's problematic on both ends. And then defensively, you can switch everything and play that way. But the defense, the rim protection is gone and the rebounding takes a hit. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be an interesting test match to see how much Ty Lue wants to go to that and basically say, you know, the usual way we play with Zubats is not optimal against this team.
To me, every minute that Zubats, Plumlee, or Tice are on the floor is good for the Mavs. And those are all capable players, but it allows the Mavs to continue to play the best version of themselves, which is big. Now, I do think that their small lineups and the net ratings and all this would reflect it, that their small lineups with PJ and Maxey are good. But I love, obviously, the dunking, the paint points, the paint protection, the rebounding, et cetera, that having Gafford or Lively on the floor.
Well, it's going to be interesting. First game is Sunday. We still don't know what time or what channel.
Yeah, we don't.
Stay tuned for that. But
first round playoff games will be on Bally Sports Southwest, unless they're on ABC.
Which is only on the weekends.
Yep.
So let's quickly, as we're running late, go through just some juicy matchups in the playoffs.
To me, look, we don't know who Oklahoma City is going to play, but it could be the Lakers. It could be the Warriors. Obviously, whoever the Lakers or Warriors play, whether it's Oklahoma City, whether it's Denver, whether one or both of them don't even make it. But if they both are in there, whoever they play, that's certainly going to be a very atypical seventh or eighth seed. I think Phoenix, Minnesota, especially since Phoenix just went into Target Center in Minneapolis yesterday with something on the line and boat raced them. I think that's a really intriguing series. Phoenix is not a typical sixth seed. And who knows where Minnesota's head is after that performance. And look, organizationally, and this is not...
And by the way, they're still trying to integrate Cat back in.
And this is not Gobert's fault or Towns' fault or Anthony Edwards' fault or anybody's fault.
Yeah, they're a mess organizationally.
But organizationally, they've only gone out of the first round one time since they came into the NBA in 1988. And that was the 04, the 03-04 season when Garnett was the MVP. On the Eastern Conference side of things, I think, look, as long as we don't know what Giannis' status is, and Indiana can score... And Rick is a good playoff coach. I mean, I think that is an intriguing matchup. I think if Embiid is ready to go, whoever Philadelphia plays, that's not a typical seven, or if they end up eight, they'll probably be seven. We'll see what happens with Philadelphia and Miami in a play-in game. But whoever Philadelphia plays, whether it's New York, whether it ends up being Boston, I mean, I don't think they would win there. But still, Philadelphia with Embiid able to play whatever he can play, along with Tyrese Maxey in their group, that is not a typical seven seed. So... there could be some upsets, dude. There could be.
All four seeds, top four seeds in both conferences, I think, are vulnerable.
Yes.
All four.
Yes.
In both. Because, look, I think if I'm going chalk, Lakers and Golden State will come out of...
Yeah. And you think even Boston is vulnerable?
Not in the first round. We'll take that one back.
Yeah.
But I think the Lakers will be seven. I mean, you look what they did yesterday. They're going to play in the same building a couple of days later. Mm-hmm. New Orleans is really good, but they're confounding sometimes.
Yes, great. They ended the year winning like four straight on the road and losing five straight at home. Crazy.
Golden State, let's pencil them at an eight. On the other side of the bracket, I think 76ers take care of Miami pretty easily. And I think Miami, although they're not the Miami of the last 4 years, a team that went to the finals two of the last 4 years, were a buzzer-beating three from making it a third year. Mm-hmm. I don't know that they're that team this year, but I do think they can take care of Chicago or Atlanta.
For sure.
So,
for sure.
They'll
be formidable. They'll be formidable. Even if they don't win, they'll make Boston work.
Make Boston work, but I think Boston comes out. Knicks and Philly, oof.
Yeah.
I like Philly a lot now with Embiid, but do the Knicks have enough firepower? Brunson's playing out of his mind.
Mm-hmm.
But without Randall, it's going to be tough. Milwaukee and Indiana, remember, Indiana won 4 of those 5 games this year.
Yeah.
And remember Ballgate? Remember, you know, the chippiness of...
oh, yeah, that's right. Gosh. It's been a long year, man. I forgot about that.
There was a lot of chippiness in that series. Could Milwaukee somehow lose in the first round for the second year in a row? That's crazy.
And obviously the Giannis health factor, of course, is a thing there too.
And Cleveland-Orlando, Cleveland is in a way right now.
Mm-hmm.
And Orlando could get a first round in a 4-5 win easily.
I mean, 4-5s historically are toss-ups.
Yes.
I believe that the 5th seed is actually one more than the 4 seed has.
It's very close. I went through the numbers last year. It's essentially 50-50. But then when you go to 3-6, it's 80-20.
Right.
So that's the gulf you're talking about and why you, in the Mavs position, you want to be in 4-5 and not 3-6. Oklahoma City, Golden State is interesting. You got Oklahoma City's first time through this rodeo.
Yeah.
And Golden State's been there, done that. Do they have one last gasp of this grouping? Because it could be broken up after this year.
My notes are in my backpack. I'm not going to get them. But I did have like this to go for a little bit of the game broadcast yesterday. You know, Shea has played in 13 playoff games, 1 year with the Clippers, 1 year with the Thunder. Lou Dort has played in 6 playoff games, 1 year with the Thunder. Gordon Hayward obviously has some playoff experience. You know, Biombo and Muscala have playoff experience, but they're not rotation guys. Maybe they're a sounding board and a voice in the locker room that could prove important. And I think maybe there is one other person that I'm forgetting that's in their rotation that
but
has
playoff
like,
experience is not grinded out.
Yeah,
you know,
they have. I mean, they're not
played
complete,
the bubble series against the Rockets.
They're not complete playoff neophytes in terms of a handful of their guys, but there are a lot of them who will be getting their first taste of it.
Denver Lakers. Lakers are one of the hottest teams in the league right now. That's going to be really interesting. And then you mentioned Minnesota. Are they ready for this? And because Phoenix, again, who knows what Phoenix teams is going to show up? But when they're they're on. So let's close quickly with some. Sad news that was announced Friday.
Somber news. We found out D'Lo posted this on his Instagram. You know, he missed a game about a month ago for personal reasons. He didn't accompany the Mavs on the road trip recently to Charlotte and Miami, which, you know, typically injured players do. And then we found out on Friday that his mom, Kathy Drysdale, who had been such a fixture at games early in the season, passed away. She's had an 11-year battle with Hodgkin's lymphoma. I mean, she played basketball at Penn State, so, you know, D-Live's love of basketball comes from a place where the fact that his mom was a great basketball player in the collegiate ranks, and she was on good teams. I mean, they were number one in the country at one point in time when Kathy played at Penn State. Kathy Phillips then, Kathy Drysdale now. I saw on the social over the weekend, Derek's already got a tattoo on his arm commemorating his mom. He's had a lot of just very touching, heartwarming, heart-wrenching post about his biggest cheerleader, his support system, his confidant. I mean, just, you know, the love and the bond of a mother and son, you know. Both of us have lost our moms, you know, you to cancer several years ago. My mom, you know, died at 88 years old 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago. You know, and there are times, you know, as a 53-year-old man, you know, it's sometimes, like I saw this on an episode of MASH one time with Radar, and I know it's weird that I'm relating this to old school television, but sometimes a guy just likes to talk to his mom.
Sure.
You know, and so Derek's lost both parents now before he turns 21 years old, and it's devastating, it's tragic, it's so sad. However, he's got a family, and it's his teammates, and it's the organization, and I think every MFFL would consider Derek Lively as part of their family because the love for him, because of his realness, his maturity, his attitude, his approach to basketball, his approach to life, everything that we've learned about him in his short time here is so positive and so wise and so mature beyond his years. And obviously, he learned a lot of that from an incredible woman and his mother.
Yeah, I lost my mom at 46, and I thought that was tough, and he's 20.
Yeah.
You know, it shook me, and I can only imagine what he's going through. But he, you know, for him to want to be there Friday night, and not only to, you know, to feel the love from the fans, but to feel the love from his teammates, because you're right, it is a second family when you're in this group, and there's only 15 of y'all, and you have an extended kind of traveling party. You know how close those bonds are, and that's his family now, and he wants to be around those that care and love for him, and so he'll get through this. He's, as you mentioned, you know, we've had interactions with him. He's such a high character guy.
High character and high maturity guy. I mean, just off the charts mature for a 20-year-old, you know, who just turned 20 years old 2 months ago.
And, you know, she will live on through him, and that is the good news of this. And
yes, so, yes, absolutely.
Our condolences to him, and know that he will be supported by all of us.
And I thought, you know, Sean Heath, when they did the moment of silence Friday night at American Airlines Center, you know, Kathy was not just a mom, but she was a daughter. She was a sister. She was a friend. I mean, this is felt by a lot of people. We understand it and feel it because it's felt by Derek Lively. But I believe, as Derek said in one of his social media posts, Brian, that she touched the lives and lit up the lives of a whole lot of people that she was that she interacted with and was related to or a significant part of their lives over the years. So it's devastating. It's heartbreaking. You know, and I know. And by the way, Brad Townsend had information about this. And I'm sure that this has been shared in other places, but that's where I would invite you to go look. The Morning News great beat writer Brad Townsend, I retweeted it yesterday. In lieu of flowers, if you want to do something to support Derek, he has named a local nonprofit. Forgive me for not remembering the name of it, but you can find it. And they provide services to the immediate family members of individuals who are battling terminal illness, particularly cancer. So,
well, that's fantastic.
Yeah, and so he, in lieu of flowers or something like that, he'd like to make a donation to that.
Look, we're an entertainment product.
Yes.
You know, we can get all riled up about MVPs and wins and losses.
We can, yes.
But at the end of the day, this is about relationships.
Yes,
and this
no
is
question.
About
well
people.
Said. Well said.
This is about the community we build from listeners and viewers.
Amen, man.
All around, and we are there for each other, and that's what it, that is the point of all this. So mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Appreciate those words from you. And,
and
our
you
best
too, man.
To Derek.
Yeah, absolutely. Amen to that.
We will be back soon after a really important game in this playoff series. We'll find out, depending on what the schedule is, because we don't know it yet. But please stay with us, tell your friends, and we'll be back with you next time on Take Dad With You with Follow and Demera, sponsored by NTTA.